Bismillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and this is part 3 about those children that were born to non-married parents in Islam. And I want to talk today about, or in this talk here, about the children in the Bible, the wedlockless children in the Bible. How does the Bible look at those children that were born out of marriage? So many laws that were and still are in the books of our cousins, the Jews and Christians, have found their way into what has been and still is being preached today in Islam. From stoning a fornicator to killing disobedient children to considering the voice of a woman a aura, an indecent limb. So basically, when they say the voice of a woman is aura, what they are saying is that when a woman speaks, her voice is as private as a human's private part or genitals. And all this and more are in the Torah, the book of the children of Israel. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because those teachings found their way into our books. And this is why women in Islam or Judaism have been having it hard since those days until today. So, does Islam and the Quran of Allah and the authentic ahadith that do not contradict the Quran, does anything say that a woman's voice is awra, like their genitals or their parts? Of course not. Neither the Quran nor the synced ahadith say such abnormality. But does the Bible say this? Yes, it does. Do Muslim scholars say the same thing as the Bible? Yes, they do. Therefore, let us see what the Bible say about those children that are born out of marriage according to Judaism and Christianity, and see how close or far are our scholars from the Bible's laws. In the Bible, it says that children that are born out of a wedlock are not and will not be accepted in the kingdom of God, that is paradise, Jannah. This is clearly mentioned in Deuteronomy 23, verse 2, where it reads as follows: no one born out of wedlock may be included among the Lord's people. But the full text sheds more light on the fate of those children that are born out of marriage, that is Judaism or Christianity, on Judgment Day, according to the Bible again. It says, no one born of a forbidden union may enter the assembly of the Lord, even to the 10th generation. None of his descendants may enter the assembly of the Lord. In another part of the Bible, things get a little more clearer, as mentioned in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verse 8, according to the New International Version. It says, if you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are not legitimate, not true son and daughters at all. What this means is that if Allah, and this is according to Judaism and Christianity, if Allah does not discipline them as a father disciplines his children, because you remember the Jews and Christians think they are the sons of Allah. So if Allah does not discipline them as a father disciplines his children, if they do not experience discipline like everyone else, then they are not legitimate. They are illegitimate children because Allah doesn't consider them as his children. Of course, from a Muslim perspective, this is not true. But I'm telling you what the Bible has. In the Old Testament, children were considered bastards if their mother, and this is talking about the children of Israel, if their mother was a non-Israelite, regardless of whether their father was an Israelite or not. This is why till today, if a child is born out of a Jewish mother, regardless of who the father is, what his religion is, that child is considered a Jew. But if the mother isn't Jewish, but the father is Jewish, then the child is not considered a Jewish, it is considered an illegitimate child, or as the language of the Bible puts it, busted. The Eastern Bible's dictionary, and this is a very good dictionary for those who study the Bible, it gives you, because it gives you a lot of meanings, tells you what their scholars say, things like that, which is, again, it gives a lot of explanation about any topic related to the Bible. This dictionary defines the biblical term bastard, because bastard is a biblical term, as being synonymous with the word polluted. This is because in the Jewish belief that God told the children of Israel not to marry into the pagans, just like Allah tells us in the Quran not to marry into the non-Muslims. But they did so, the children of Israel did so anyway, and they married into other nations forbidden by Allah to them. He called their offspring of such unapproved marriages bastards, so they are polluted. And now we understand why An-Nawawi came with that idea that the sperm of the man is polluted, it's void, it's rotten, it's not safe, and it doesn't. It's exactly the same belief in the Judaic or Judaism religion. And now let me bring forth the other side of the coin that is present in the book of Fiqh, on our jurisprudence, written by many scholars throughout 14 centuries that have put these writings and kept hidden from the general Muslims public because of political influences, agendas, and school of thoughts arguments. Here is a real-life example that many scholars have debated non-stop, and that is the issue of attributing children that are born out of Muslim wedlock to the father that beget them. Someone asked a question on Islam QA. The fatwa number is 192131. It is all in Arabic. The fatwa, as I said, is in Arabic, and the only text in English is what I translated here. But I could not translate the whole fatwa, because the whole answer was a staggering number of 301 lines. 301 line to answer the following question, which is, in some fatwa, that is Islamic rulings, this is the person asking, Sheikh Al-Munajjid, who is the supervisor of Islam QA, he asks him this question. On your website, you mentioned that the son of fornication cannot be attributed to the man who fathered him or her. And you mentioned that this fatwa is the opinion of the great number of scholars. But then, in another fatwa, you mentioned that it is possible to attribute the son of fornication to his father. Can you shed some light on this with evidences to support your conclusions? Again, the answer given by Sheikh overlooking the website is very, 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 very long one, and unbelievable, as I said, 301 line to be specific, in which the Sheikh went to a great length to explain and answer the question. Because remember, in his first fatwa, he always was the hardcore one, and someone surprised him with this answer. Now he has to undo what he already gave the fatwa upon, and that is a difficult task. And the reason behind, again, such a lengthy one is because throughout the 1,400 years, so many scholars held a different view on this issue than what people are saying today, and what is the mainstream fatwas of the Salafi school of thought Wahhabi are telling people today. If you read over the 300 lines of the Arabic explanation, you will literally get a headache due to the tennis game played by the people of knowledge to establish something that actually didn't need to be established had they consulted and acted on the Quran first. But as usual, when the issue has been dealt without consulting the Quran first, a world of confusion and contradictions is open, and the door to doubt and head scratching and hair pulling is carved into this beautiful religion of ours, Al-Islam. So after 301 line, the Sheikh closed his fatwa by saying the following, because he mentioned a plethora of names, and this scholar said, and that scholar said, and this one said, and that one said, you will really get a headache. But at the end of the whole fatwa, he says, the statement of forbiddance and allowance, i.e. forbidden to attribute the child to the father, or allowing the attribution of the child to his father, he guess, are two valid statements with the people of knowledge. Subhanallah. People are giving fatwa, it's haram, 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 haram. And now he's saying there are other scholars that say are halal, 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 halal. How? No wonder people don't trust those scholars anymore. But anyway, he goes, are two valid statements with the people of knowledge. And this issue of attributing the child to his father, the fornicator, is an issue of interpretative judgment or ijtihad, and is left to the independent of the scholar's opinion, and each instant is to be dealt with independently. And I say to this kind of knowledge that this kind of attitude has caused a great deal of problems already. In the Muslim world, the issue of children born out of marriage is widely spread, and the closed way of thinking and the mind narrowness of these scholars that promote this vengeful and hateful status of those children had not done anything good to us Muslims. These people thought and still are thinking that by making things haram and forbidden on us, they are actually being pious and are spreading the fear of Allah in the hearts of people, when in fact they are just causing people to lose hope and lose all form of mercy from their God, Allah. Despite what the Sheikh al-Munajjid said, and I refer to his statement of the statement of forbiddance and allowance are two valid statements with the people of knowledge. Why on earth don't they say this whenever somebody asks about the issue of children born out of marriage? Why don't they say that there is a difference of opinion between the scholars? Of course, if they took the Quran, they would not open their mouth with such nonsense. But because they put the Quran behind their back, this is where we end up to, and this is where our calamity and problems are today. I say to him, this ijtihad for 1400 years in the Saudi Arabia, and what the Salafis promote and what the Wahhabi promote, this is, as I said the first time, he doesn't inherit, you can't attribute it to the father should not support him, this and that and this. And now he tell me that it is related to an interpretative judgment ijtihad and is left to the independent opinion of the scholar. Like the scholar is up to him to say it's halal haram. We don't have any evidences anymore. We can't argue the case by saying Allah says it no longer is valid that Allah says. Now it's entirely up to the scholar. Subhanallah al-haq. But in any way, so the school of thought he follows and promotes, and that is the Wahhabi approach, is also, as I said, the Salafi. They widely preach that the son of fornication, as they refer to them, or children born out of zina, as we are haram to attribute them to their father, and this created a headache, and that they mentioned the hadith as if they were absolute truth. And as I said it before, and I will say it now, any hadith you hear, and this any, We cannot say it is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We're not sure that it is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam who said it 100%. It's only an assumption. It's only a doubt. We think maybe, probably, even if it is authentic by Bukhari and 6,000 Muslims behind him, it only is an assumption, a possibility that Rasulullah said the meaning of that. The words exactly we cannot always, and I will do a talk about how the hadith was collected so that you get a better understanding of this big false play that is being played on us. Anytime you hear your mouth to ask a question or to challenge an answer, you are faced with, the Prophet says, you reject the Sunnah. No, I am not rejecting the Sunnah. I believe in the Sunnah. But as soon as this Sunnah contradicts the Quran or puts the Quran in a very difficult situation, I am sorry, I do not follow what you are telling me. But in any case, it is very depressing and totally unjust to see someone who is born inside the wedlock but is not a God-fearing person, doesn't implement the laws and commands of Allah as Allah intends them, to feel superior and more noble in comparison to someone who was born out of marriage, but is in every way, every day better than the other, the community will patronize, judge, and isolate those children that are born out of marriage, and they will ensure those children suffer for being a child born because of a sinful act committed by people out of their control. This indeed is very sad. This indeed is heartbreaking, and this reality exists in the Muslim lands and even within the Muslim community these days here in the West. When you approach these communities to educate them, they will present you with the intense Salafi opinion as thus I have mentioned at the beginning of this pep talk. These communities have been preached non-stop that children born out of wedlock are children of haram, and just like haram wealth, they are not welcome. And these very simple people who will torture those children born out of a marriage, either emotionally, psychologically, and even physically, will then turn to the rest of the world to tell them that Islam is a religion of love, mercy, peace, and harmony. Yet the most loveless, merciless, placeless, and chaotic nations on earth today are Muslims. Muslims are people you hear too often say that the Quran is the most authentic book, and indeed it is. They claim it contains solution to the world problems, that it is valid and suitable for everyone, everywhere, and everyone. They will tell anyone who would lend them half an ear to every group, every tribe, every town, and every people, continent, and the world as it stands today, that the Quran and the religion it brings, Islam, means peace, means love, means this and that. Yet, they are the first to toss aside this very book for the saying of this or that scholar, even if it contradicts the book of Allah, as we saw in this pep talk. We live in a time where religiousness has become very cosmetic. A beard, the longer it is, the more religious a person is, or so we think. A headscarf, a floaty garment that is black and face covered, and wearing some gloves, that is also very religious and very pious, very Allah obedient. A trousers worn above the ankles, the number of counted subhanallah here and alhamdulillah there. And the moment you say something about, say, brushing the teeth with a siwak and that you should use a toothbrush instead, you get attacked that you are belittling this act or that sunnah and this and that. Yet when someone rejects a universal truth found in the Quran or a clear evidence or text in the book of Allah, you don't get attacked that you are belittling the Quran or destroying it, because to them the Quran is very open to their play and mutilation under their man-invented ideology of abrogation. Take an example. This issue, who the child can be attributed to. The Quran clearly and undoubtedly states that the child must be attributed to the two that brought him, her, to this world. But you'd see Muslims ignore what Allah says because this or that scholar says something that doesn't go along with the Quran. And instead of bringing the Quran first, they bring what the other scholar said first. As soon as you mention something from the Quran that doesn't agree with what the school of thoughts preach, you'll find them running to what scholars have said, even if the evidence is as clear as the sun in the midst of the sky at noon on a cloudless sunny summer day in the heart of a desert Central Africa. They will still reject the Quran. This type of devilish approach has created confusions and contradictions and planted along with it a lot of sour, bitter, and poisonous beliefs that lead Muslims to only verbally talk about the Quran with the belief of uncertainty about its message. Muslims have lost trust in the book of Allah descended from Allah to them. So what's wrong with saying that if two people, a man and a woman, made an error, fornicated, and as a result to what they did, a child or two or three were born? What's wrong with saying the children are, as clearly mentioned in the Quran, must be attributed to the father and he must support them financially and take care and provide with them a habitat and everything and give them his name? What's wrong with saying that? We're not innovating. We're just saying what the Quran said. If someone doubts us, then we just produce the countless texts from the Quran, et voila. All those children born out of marriage that have been shunned in the Bible will find home in the Quran. But sadly today, when those children born out of marriage are shunned from the Bible, and when they come to Islam, they will find the same ruling and even worse. Why would you want them to accept Islam? They don't even they get more repulsive towards a religion that calls them sons of haram, sons of fornication, as our scholars say it. The internet is full of scholarly poisonous and horrid statements which have rendered Muslims deprived of intelligence. The Quran says something, and because the scholar says something else, then what the hadith says takes precedence over the Quran, and this is why we are where we are today, at the far bottom of the food chain. The million-dollar question that we must ask ourselves is, why, oh why? Allah has openly and beyond any shadow of doubt declared that Islam is a religion of easiness. وَمَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. And he has not placed upon you in the religion any haraj. The term haraj means difficulties, hardship, awkwardness, uneasiness, discomfort, shame, humiliation, distress, agitation, perturbation, and the likes. All those things are not part of Al-Islam. So how can we explain to a child who, of no fault of theirs, were born out of marriage, that their status is labeled son of fornication or son of haram? How can we tell them that Islam categorizes them as the worst of the worst of the three? Where is the mercy in that? Where is the lack of haraj for them? Where is the lack of difficulties, hardship, awkwardness, uneasiness, discomfort, shame, humiliation, distress, agitation, perturbation for them? How can a Muslim who is born out of marriage relates to this ayah in the book of Allah, when Allah says to you, me, and to the child who is born out of a wedlockless relationship, Taha, ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'an litashqa. Taha, we have not descended the Qur'an upon you, so you distress. Those children that were born out of wedlockless, aren't they distressed? Look at how they are mistreated and treated, and how the scholars say he doesn't take the name of his father, he doesn't connect with his father, he can't inherit from his father, he doesn't do this. It's why isn't that a big, huge distress? Isn't that big complication in life? The Quran is not a book of distress. It does not generate stress, nor leads to a depressing life, correct? Well, to a child who is born out of wedlock in a Muslim land, he will live the worst of their lives within the Muslim community. And this is a problem, really a problem. Another evidence is from the hadith that our scholars should have paid attention to before saying what they said, the evil of what has been reported on their behalf. On the day of Al-Qiyamah, and this creates a huge problem to those scholars who stripped and still stripped those children who are born out of marriage from the very right to belong to their fathers. And those scholars that have led us into the icy waters of contradictions, doubt, uncertainty, and conflicts is what shall happen on the day of judgment. For your information, my dear sisters and my brothers, what is halal today on earth will be halal on judgment day. What's haram on earth today is haram on judgment day. What's a law on earth today will be a law on judgment day. And as such, if Allah has condemned or commanded, ordered or instructed us to attribute children to the man who fathered them, then on judgment day, when they will be called to the standing in front of Allah, they will be called by the name and the name of their father. Because Allah is not going to command us to call them to their fathers and on the day of judgment call them differently. He will call them to the name of their fathers, not the husband who has been away for 20 years. We, along with the men of religion, fully know that Allah's knowledge is boundless, timeless, placeless. His knowledge is comprehensive, supreme, rapid. Everything that ever existed or was to exist or shall exist, both in this life or in the hereafter, is known to Allah. Nothing ever evades His knowledge. Allah's knowledge doesn't have an end. Many fiqh issues have been dealt with purely and solely based on transmitted hadiths without any input from the Quran. For those scholars of hadith, their main concern was to establish that the chain of narrators is authentic without checking the meaning of a hadith against the Quran. And should the two clash, then one of them has to be put on the shelf. And sadly, it is always the Quran that gets put on the shelf, and the issue on hand is a huge proof. The problem starts from the naming of those children, sons of fornications or sons of haram, even though Allah has forbidden their appellation, label or insults in the Quran. Listen to this clear ayah. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who believed, la yaskhar qawmun min qawmin, let not a people ridicule or scoff at another people, don't make fun of other people, asa an yakunu khayran minhum, in case they may be, after all, better than them. ولا نساء من نساء. Not let women ridicule or scoff or make fun of other women. عسى أن يكون خيرا منهن. They who may, after all, be better than the other women. ولا تلمزوا أنفسكم. And do not insult, defame, nor speak ill of one another. ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب. And this is what I want to drive in. And do not call one another with bad nicknames or use offensive nicknames for one another. بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان. Bad is the name of sinfulness after embracing faith. ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون. And whosoever does not repent from such an evil, then such are indeed the wrongdoers and the transgressors. How could our scholars label those children born out of wedlock sons of fornication or sons of haram? Why didn't they just call them the children who are born out, parents are not married? Why didn't they name them in a manner that puts the emphasis on the wrongness of the parents and innocence of the kids? When Allah has clearly prohibited calling each other with bad nicknames or offensive nicknames. Now, someone might say they didn't call them that, it's just a description or reference. Again, the divine command are clear. Don't do it for whatever reason. Yet till today, labeling people and cornering them with nicknames is still the deed of the self-appointed guardians of Islam, the Salafis or the Wahhabis. To them, anyone who doesn't subscribe to their point of view is this or that, and they give them a very bad nickname or offensive nicknames. Anyway, a hadith that totally goes in agreement with the Quran is a hadith reported by Al-Bukhari and also Muslim, in which it is reported that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, إِذَا جَمَعَ اللَّهُ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخَرِينَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. When Allah gathers together on the day of judgment or the day of standing up in front of Him, all the early and late generations, so every humans are there. يَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ لِكُلِّ غَادِرٍ لِوَاءٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah, or a flag, will be raised to mark off every person's guilty of breach or betrayal. Is like a banner that will be held on top of that person there. فيقال, and it will be said, هذه غدرة فلان ابن فلان. And it will be announced, this is the treachery or disloyalty, betrayal of so and so, son of son and so, referring to his father. And in another hadith also reported by Abu Dawood with a very good chain of narrator, it's not Jayyid, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said in the meaning, إِنَّكُمْ تُدْعَوْنَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. You will be called on the day of standing up in front of Allah. بِأَسْمَائِكُمْ وَأَسْمَائِ آبَائِكُمْ. By your names and the names of your fathers. فَأَحْسِنُوا أَسْمَاءَكُمْ. So give yourselves nice names. You see, there is nothing that you take the mother's name and all this nonsense. The Quran says the child belongs to the father. The hadith says the child belongs to the father. On the day of Qiyamah, Allah is going to call you, man or woman, by your name and the name of the man who fathered you. So how did on earth our scholars and Nawawi, how can he say that the water or the sperm of this man is void, rotten and polluted, as the Bible said it? So will Allah call those children that are born out of illegal marriage in Islam, so to speak, with their names and the name of their father? Or will he call them with their names and the name of a husband who's been away for 20 years? Or is he gonna call them by the name, their names and name of their mother? The pure answer is their name and the name of their fathers. So my dear sisters and my brothers, in conclusion, what I would say about those children that were born out of a wedlock in Muslim religion, I'm not talking about others, remember at the beginning of what I said, that the self-pretentious Salafi school of thought dared to promote this far extremist wrong, absolutely wrong view. And this wrong view is sadly spread all over the Muslim land today, and we should do our best to fight it off. And one of the reasons as to why these harsh rulings, now I'm going to tell you why they don't say a lot of things, is because at the time when these, remember when I said at one point that all our Islam that you believe in, either creed or all those books and what the scholars said and the hadith, all those things have been written under the influence of politics and culture influences. So at the time when these things were going on, the Abbasi and Banu Umayyah started launching wars against other nations. In Bani Umayyah, Muawiyah started fighting other people because he wanted to distract people with the big problems that he had internally with Ali radiallahu anhu, and the killing of Al-Hasan, the killing of Ali, Al-Hussein, and all these uproars and all the problems and conflicts and all that kind of stuff. Muawiyah wanted to distract people by sending them away to battles. They invented a hadith about fighting for the sake of Allah. They invented terminologies. They did invent a great deal. You don't believe me? Look at the scholar Saudi today in Saudi Arabia, how they support. They say what the ruler, the king says. Sudaisi now is praising America, and he's doing a lot of things. It's almost like, wow, it's kind of like a new skin that this person has. The same thing was happening back in time. So when Muawiyah used to send people away, they used to send them for a long period of time. Now, man goes to fight and Muslim died and things like that. What happened in the different parts of the Muslim lands at that time there? The young people, and always remember, people are not angels. So the young man started wooing and chasing women, picking up women and things like that. And at one point, the children of fornication, or those children that were, started growing. The number became unbearable. So what the scholar did, they started first of all naming the child as Ibn Zina, child of fornication, child of a zina. And they devised this understanding to repel people to sleep with women of the soldiers that were away. And they kind of like they built this hatred into the community so that the women get scared of sleeping with other men because their husbands were away. And that created that kind of understanding that is with us today. That the child who is born to the fornicating man doesn't take his name, doesn't inherit, doesn't this, and the woman gets the burden of the finance, and instead of the man taking care of the kid, it's the woman who will go to her family, and she'll be ashamed, and the husband, when he comes back from the fight, is going to find the woman pregnant, and all this nonsense is, everything about it is pushed politically. Because as you have seen, the Quran disapproves with this. The Quran has said whose name the child should carry. It's the father of the person who must support the child. As Allah says in the Quran, is the one who gave birth to the child. Who must do this is child, and who must do this. The Quran speaks the truth. As far as the Quran is concerned, a child is a child. Either it comes from married parents or unmarried parents. If the married parents bring a child on earth, they get a reward for that. If the unmarried parents bring a child to earth, they get the sins of that. And on the day of Al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall rule amongst people. Look here in England today. I'll give an example, and that is how Islam looks at things. Today when you go to school, you have children that have their parents married, and other children, they have parents that are not married. At school, it absolutely makes no difference at all between the children. The school looks at them, and it's in the minds of children here, it's the same thing. Because that is exactly vis-a-vis how Allah looks at it. The kids are children. And as one person said, there are no illegitimate children. There are illegitimate parents. And we must stop looking at those issue from a different hadithic fuqaha scholars issue angle, and you must look at them from how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at them. To Allah, a human is a human. I could have spoken for hours, but I had to limit it as far as I could to this, and as you can see, it took three parts to cover the whole thing. So in conclusion, a child that is born out to parents that were not married is absolutely fine. It can be remarried, and you can marry. So if you know someone and he comes to ask you for the hand of your daughter and his parents are not married, treat him 100% as your own child. That is absolutely all that is that you must pay attention to, is his behavior, the way they are, his Islam, and all these things that every parent should ensure that the girl is going to a man who will take care and he is responsible. And the same thing, if your child is going to marry a woman, you want him to marry to a responsible woman who is well-educated, well-behaved, it's got good morals and good Islamic behavior. how they came to earth is none of our business, because we all came through the same way. We all were drop of sperm into our mothers and we all born. Allah mentioned that universal reality, and this universal truth must be followed by the Muslims because it's in Al-Quran. I completely reject what these scholars have said. And alhamdulillah, Al-Sheikh Al-Munajjid said in his fatwa when he was talking about the contradictory issue, he says the statement of forbiddance and allowance are two valid statements. Why then should you push the hard negative one, and why don't you go for the other one? Because that is how the Salafi thrives, is in making things harder than they are. I pray to Allah this opens the door in front of your eyes. The children are fine. If they get married, their children are fine. Everything about those people is beautiful. It's who they are, what they do, that will define them, not how they came on earth and who their parents were, that will define them. I pray to Allah that this talk has brought to you some understanding, some better joy, some better beautiful things about Al-Islam. Allah knows more. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Again, this is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on my WhatsApp group, which is +44 78 76 40 87 35. And you can also check this talk and others on my YouTube channel at Islam Pep Talk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.